tell you I'm thrilled to be here, and I want to thank you so much for inviting me. This is a topic I truly love to talk about, and I think you have a real treat in store for you with your upcoming exhibition. I really appreciate this more than I can say, and deeply honored to be a part of this lecture series. I entitled my talk, The Curious Case of George O'Keefe's Modernity, and I included aspects that people don't normally think about in association with O'Keefe, her education in combination with abstraction, and various locations for her finding her own identity. So let's start first with the word modern. If we take the word modern to mean up-to-date, or contemporary, or new, then being modern surely must be connected to the moment. Forever shape-shifting in a world that's moving too fast to be fully described. And if this is true, then a modern artist should be on the leading edge of time. Modern artists should be a pacemaker, a trendsetter. And if this is true, George O'Keefe's modernity could be measured by the number and frequency of firsts on her resume. So let's start with talking about the number of firsts on George O'Keefe's resume. So here on our first slide of her charcoals from 1915. In 1915, George O'Keefe became the first female abstract artist in America. Along with Arthur Dove and Marston Hartley and Charles Demuth and John Maron, she was a member of America's first generation of modernists that frequented Alfred Stieglitz's galleries. Now I get to try out this pointer here. In 1919, as a fearless member of the New York avant-garde, she challenged all definitions of art, even social norms, called her own paintings music. Her love for Alfred Stieglitz and his passion for photography, as well as her support for his new styled and unprecedentedly intimate portrait of a woman, made her especially well known in 1921 when Stieglitz's photographs of her were exhibited at the Anderson Galleries in New York, including this photograph here. On the right, you have a painting called Music, which is in the Whitney Museum. In 1925, she made a name for herself with unprecedented gigantic flower paintings. In 1926, she utilized this new spatial format to tackle the giganticism of New York skyscraper, the only woman in her generation to do so. And I just want to make a footnote about the market. She was well rewarded for these endeavors by a devoted following of patrons. And by 1930, at the point she started traveling west regularly, she was financially independent. Among the most successful artists in America, her career spanned nearly 50 years, across nearly three generations when you think about it. In 1943, the year her first pelvis paintings, in the year of her first pelvis painting, she was the first female artist to receive a retrospective at the Art Institute of Chicago. And in 1946, the year she began making paintings of the door of her house in Abiquiu, she was the first female artist to receive a retrospective at the Museum of Modern Art. And so here you have an image that should be very familiar to you here. And this is her first painting of a patio door. So I'm setting you up here with all these firsts, all these accolades, these wonderful things. So when I tell you that in 1946, when she had her first, when she had her retrospective at the Museum of Modern Art, Clement Greenberg, the critic Clement Greenberg, gave her a terrible review. He declared O'Keefe not modern, but pseudo-modern. He wrote, "The importance of Georgia O'Keefe's pseudo-modern art," and this is a quote from his article, "the importance of Georgia O'Keefe's pseudo-modern art is almost entirely historical and symptomatic. The errors it exhibits are significant because of the time and place and context in which they were made. Otherwise, her art has very little value. The deftness and precision of her brush and the neatness with which she places a picture inside its frame exerts a certain inevitable charm, which may explain her popularity. And some of her architectural subjects may even more than charm. But the greatest part of her work adds up to little more than tinted photography. The lapidarian patience she has expended in trimming and breathing upon and polishing these bits of opaque cellophane betrays a concern that has less to do with art than with the private worship and the embellishment of private fetishes with secret and arbitrary meaning." Ultimately, his article concludes, "That an institution as influential as the Museum of Modern Art should dignify this arty manifestation with a large-scale exhibition is a bad sign." And that was written in The Nation on June 15th, 1946. Now, I always like to set things up with a bit of a misreading, just to run things alongside to get us thinking. So let's think about this. And here I'm showing you a Pollock drip painting and a John Maron landscape. And this is sort of a landscape improvisation from 1947, and the drip painting is from 1948. So I'm going to say, just for the sake of argument, that perhaps Greenberg was right, partly. In 1946, O'Keefe was certainly not on the leading edge. Certainly did not possess the style of the moment. At the moment, Greenberg championed Pollock. At the moment, John Maron, not George O'Keefe, was the member of the first generation of modernists considered to be the precursor of gesture or action painting. Nevertheless, I will say, and this is the thrust of my argument, that he was absolutely wrong about her modernity. Perhaps Greenberg's complaints about O'Keefe's allegiance to deftness, precision, the framing of space, even her use of photography, were not attributes of a style at all, but attributes of a set of beliefs, a set of values, modes of perception, a process of abstraction, imagination, and reflection, which O'Keefe practiced her entire career, and which points to the true source of her modernity. And what is that? What is that true source, you might ask? Well, I believe the true source of O'Keefe's modernity lies in her education. This education was not, I repeat, not acquired in an art academy, not at the Art Institute, not at the Art Students League. No. In 1908, O'Keefe's success in William Merritt Chase's class, which you see here, this is a 1908 photograph, and O'Keefe, they tell me, is somewhere in this photograph, but I can't find it for you, I'm so sorry. And on the right here is O'Keefe's painting of the dead rabbit in the copper pot that won her a prize. She got to spend the summer at Lake George painting. She won this prize. And you can see the model for her painting came from, or the objects chosen were the objects that were in a Chardin still life. And then here is a painting near and dear to my heart by William Merritt Chase that is in the Phillips collection called Hide and Seek. So O'Keeffe won approval from Chase by painting like Chase. You can see the open, empty center and the way in which she weights her composition. She was emulating Chase. But it left her at a dead end, or at least she believed she was at a dead end. This was Chase's work. This was not her work. And O'Keeffe put down her brushes for 4 years. And as a creature of chronology myself, Jennifer keeps saying I was asking you for the dates of this and that. As a creature of chronology myself, I tend to mind the gap. 4 years. She put down her brushes for 4 years. This is someone who grew up declaring to the world she was going to be an artist. Now, O'Keeffe's awakening happened at a university. O'Keeffe was among one of the first university-trained artists, which becomes a phenomenon in the 20th century. Starting in the summer of 1912, attending Alan Beeman's lectures at the University of Virginia, I might add, no prejudice there, she learned about the methods and principles of the art education reformer Arthur Wesley Dowd. As she recalled, quote, "This man had one dominating idea, to fill space in a beautiful way, and that interested me." Now, for the next 4 summers, she would return to UVA, first as a student and finally as an instructor. In the fall of 1914, she enrolled at Columbia University to study with Dow himself, spent most of the academic year in New York City, where she connected with the writings of Kandinsky, visited shows at Alfred Stieglitz's Gallery 291, all of which indirectly complemented Dow's instruction and the aspirations of her generation for self-realization. So I'm going to show you this picture of O'Keeffe in Charlottesville. There she is. She's a tree hugger. She did own Lambeth's book on trees and did go camping quite often in the Blue Ridge. In any case, and then on the right, I do want you to see also a painting, what a painting by Arthur Wesley Dow looks like. 1914, this painting of a lily, water lily. Admittedly, Dow himself did not produce modern art. He was more of a post-Victorian, if you want to call it that. But his philosophy and his exercises would change O'Keeffe's life. Dow's book of composition declared realism to be the death of art. Dow's lessons in line and color structured art not by copying nature, but by dividing the space of composition and setting into motion distinct aesthetic relationships such as opposition, transition, repetition, and symmetry. At the heart of this enterprise lay the apprehension of beauty. To appreciate the balance of two lines would be to find the beautiful. Dow maintained that all great art, both ancient and modern, both decorative and fine art, in the East and in the West, supported these findings. Dow himself had studied Asian art with Ernest Fenollosa, a Harvard-educated philosopher, a Tendai Buddhist, a member of the Kano school of artists, which he viewed as the heir to Buddhist painting of the Tang and the Sung dynasties. In 1891, at the time of his first meeting with Dow, Fenollosa's first meeting with Dow, Fenollosa was a curator of Asian art at the MFA Boston and had just returned from Japan with a zeal to reform American culture, making speeches along the Chautauqua Circuit at Winona Lake in 1900. It was Fenollosa who supplied the philosophical foundations for Dow's book of composition. At the time O'Keefe was a student at Columbia University, Ernest Fenollosa posthumously published the epics of his volume entitled The Epics of Chinese and Japanese Art, opened Dow students to the art of precise detail, whose eloquence came from clarity of thought, not sentiment. The Sung artist's vision was free and flexible, quick to make novel combinations. Fenollosa pointed out how ancient aesthetics anticipated the looser relational thinking necessary to select a path among the rapidly changing visual patterns of the modern world. So I just want to show you this one illustration of an image by Seshu, in Fenollosa's book. But as you can see here, are not anything that would jump out at us as modern art. Here are some textiles that are reproductions of textiles from Dow's book. Here are some line drawings with the Japanese brush. Also ways in which you could frame or create a compositional space. Images of that sort. I think there's one more here. A calla lily framed in this compositional space, showing a partial view. To subscribe to Dow's methods and Fenollosa's philosophy, and I'm showing you O'Keefe's own classroom in Canyon, Texas. On the left, O'Keefe's own drawing with the Japanese brush, the two lines. To subscribe to Dow's method and Fenollosa's philosophy, as O'Keefe did, was in essence to enlist in the cause of universal arts education in America, which had applications down to the kindergarten level. Dow wrote, "The study of composition means art education for the entire people, for every child can be taught to compose, that is, to know and feel beauty and to produce it in simple ways." This message was pluralistic and far-reaching, transcending gender, class, and race. We would do well to remember O'Keefe's considerable commitment to teaching reform, to remember that from 1912 to 1914 she taught in Amarillo, Texas, and in the fall of 1915 in Columbia, South Carolina, and in Canyon, Texas, from 1915 to 1918. Consider how year after year, O'Keefe, like a Zen guide along the path of understanding, staged exercises in the book of composition in progressive order, first building simple harmonies such as a straight line dividing a sheet, and then proceeding to greater complexities. At each level came the time for the student to exercise free choice, a chance to reorient a pattern of an image or a rug or a textile. Perhaps the most radical aspect of composition was the prospect of an awakened sense of power for its readers. Dow's radicalism then came not by students mastering particular facts, but by their seeing, experiencing, and creating their own systems and their own spatial structures. Dow said, "The power is within. The question is how to reach it and use it." And I'm just pointing quickly to O'Keefe's drawing, which I think is nothing less than a high wire act, where a line of vision and the line of this Japanese brush becomes one. Her power, her focus of concentration, the ability to move that line, inflect the brush, bring it down, turn it back, creating this new sense of space. And then to develop a parallel line and notice the distance between those two lines and how she raises it up without lifting a brush, turns it down, and then pulls it up again. That is an amazing feat of control, which she was very proud of, I might add. And notice on her walls, you've got images of textiles. You also have ancient art. You have black figure vases. Here on her table, I once spent a very, very long time looking at a close-up of this image, trying to identify all the pottery. There's Van Riegel pottery there. This textile, we believe, is a Viennese secession pattern. These were things that she put out for her students to consider. Three more of the charcoals from 1915. Now, O'Keeffe claimed her own aesthetic awakening, and this is a creation story that gets told over and over again. After teaching the book of composition for 3 years, it occurred one evening in December 1915 at her post in Columbia, South Carolina. She was on her hands and knees, filling out papers on the floor with large swaths of charcoal. Her marks indicated movement made with the whole arm, from the shoulder, holding the stick upright, touching down with keen control and concentration, as Dow recommended, without resting the hand. Abstraction here, in the instance of these charcoals, is not a style. I want to tell Clement Greenberg, this is not a style, but an action. And O'Keeffe's actions locate something vivid and vital, call it a line of attention, in the realm of composition that mirrored an active mind, fetching something new out of the stream of consciousness and registering it on the field of consciousness for all to see on the field of composition. These do not resemble. There is no precedent for these. Here we might say O'Keeffe can be considered truly modern because she has invented her own way to capture an interior experience with a new kind of image. At 291, Alfred Stieglitz received them as a form of suppressed speech. He said, "Finally, a woman on paper." O'Keeffe agreed that she had conveyed something all her own. These lines uncoiling on this empty paper and the luminous empty spaces left in their wake seem to have shaken the elements of style free from all traditional restraints. Gone are the rhyme and meter of foreground, midground, and background. Gone is the natural law of gravity. What remains in these images is the immediate disposition or proximity to a radiant node or a cluster of energy. Things in motion and motion in things. The configurations present themselves variously. You could see them as a fountain or tendrils or waves rushing. It's very significant that O'Keeffe kept these drawings with her always. Now I'm showing you some abstractions from the late 20s, 1926 and 27, respectively. Just to show you how O'Keeffe made her practice, artistic practice, out of composition, how she moved forward. Once an idea of an image came clear, she would lay down a line. Now, interestingly enough, these lines cut space, but do not fracture or change form. Why aren't these paintings split in half? The rhythms of the tonal surfaces come and go as if breathing. The contours alternately emerge in 3D and then dissolve into space. As a result, space itself gets pleated or folded or turned or bent. The way space is cut and contoured became a part of her expression. O'Keeffe never could decide also on the ultimate size of her compositions. Each one is very unique, very different. The images themselves remain contingent, incomplete, provisional, to be completed by the viewer. I just want to show you, just sort of walk with me a minute through these, because if you see how she divides this composition in half, then she, through her shading, lifts this layer of space as if to peer behind it, and then it scoots back under there, then emerges again and flips here over. Space becomes a thing to be bent and folded and ultimately blended. I've always become so curious now about what's behind there and how it works. And so was she. I show you this photograph from 1923. This is her Anderson Gallery show. And it was the first retrospective she had since her last exhibit at 291, which I believe was in 1917. And I wanted you just to notice the different sizes of these compositions. I don't think there are any two that are exactly alike. Also notice that she has both abstraction and representational work. But every subject dictated the size, not the other way around. I think it's quite interesting. And although she would complain about exhibitions, O'Keeffe was ambitious for her invention because she wanted her work to engage, to challenge, to kindle an experience or a response. Or dare I say teach? Perhaps I think O'Keeffe remained a teacher. As a modernist, O'Keeffe knew that the world was moving far too fast to be described, and the knowledge she imparted was only partial and relational. She needed her audience. So now I want you to picture O'Keeffe, as Stieglitz did, united in purpose with an assembly of writers and artists such as Paul Rosenfeld and Charles Duncan around the summer supper table on the porch at Lake George. Outdoor, these modern-day Thoreaus invoked experiences of living poetry like the leaves of a tree which precede flowers and fruit, not a fossil earth, but a living earth. They conversed about particular aspects of nature, but unlike their transcendentalist forebears, in part thanks to Fenollosa, Dow's mentor, they were formalists. Cathay, which was Fenollosa's compilation of Chinese poetry, translated by Ezra Pound, had been circulating among them since April 1915. And Pound would credit Fenollosa's renewed emphasis on perception, together with renewed consciousness of the structure of words, indeed the renewed consciousness of the root and structure of all language itself, with enabling modern poets, like modern painters, to break free from romantic metaphor of mood or impression, or to unfold a more objective system. As poet William Carlos Williams declared, no idea but in things. And as painter Max Weber exhorted, things, objects, mutely cry to us, touch us, feel us, see us, understand us, learn us, make us more than we are, through your association, through your tactile and spiritual intimacy. During the summer of 1921, surrounded by poets and a bumper crop in the old orchards at Lake George, O'Keeffe first approached her idea of objectivity in the manner of an exquisite haiku when she painted a knobby green apple against a smooth black oval plate floating against the empty white field. If, as Fenollosa admonished, nature has no grammar, then the simplicity of O'Keeffe's composition would supply it. Like her philosophy, O'Keeffe's artistic practice was at once atavistic and modern. Picture O'Keeffe as Stieglitz did, seated beside the garden, holding a Japanese brush over a block of watercolor paper. Here was a tool, as Dow said, perfected by ages of practice in line and paper, line drawing and brushwork. Such a tool facilitated a certain fluency between hand and eye. The color arabesques on the block besides O'Keeffe are abstract. As Dow would say, not a picture of a flower is sought, that can be left to the botanist, but rather an irregular pattern of lines and spaces. So here we see O'Keeffe holding the brush. This is a Japanese mat. I once had people from the Freer Sackler come and look at O'Keeffe's posture there, and how she was holding the brush and how she was on the mat, and they complained bitterly that she was doing it all wrong. But it's definitely a pose, and it's definitely something that is meant to show her and how she valued that brush. Here is a watercolor on a fairly large piece of paper. I should have made this little oil painting much smaller, just to give you a relative difference. But you can see this is a canna, a small painting of a canna. O'Keeffe took something all her own from photography, from Stieglitz's photography, too. So you think about it was once atavistic and once modern. She would marry her intense, luminous color with the strongly modeled forms of the photographer's grayscale and the shallow spaces of the close-up. And the intensity of that color is achieved by a particular kind of application of paint. She invented ways of achieving that sensation and that saturation of color. And I was just speaking with my colleague formerly of Phillips about this in terms of the way she would use very little medium in order to favor a very rich kind of color. Here was a new way to handle paint and the best way to achieve her goal, as she said, and actually the goal of all modernists, which is to clarify in paint the most definite form of the intangible thing inside myself. And furthermore, O'Keeffe would show Stieglitz that her abstraction could do something that photography could not. If photography worked from the conscious mind, O'Keeffe worked from the unconscious. If photographic close-ups reproduced every detail, then O'Keeffe's isolated details would then show one contour, a single color. She would be reducing things to an essence. And on the left, the red canna, and on the right, the white rose. I don't know why I needed to say that. But in any case, O'Keeffe saw the canna as red, and the petals reddened, as you can see in her application of color, against yellow and violet. One action promotes the other. To magnify the scale is to upset the aesthetic distance, to accentuate the power of the senses and to promote the imagination. And by the end of 1924, she had the invention, call it her mechanism for seeing, this close-up. But the device remained to be tested, that is, exhibited. In 1925, was the year O'Keeffe first offered busy New Yorkers her giant flowers. When the giant canna outgrew the frame, she took command of Stieglitz's Seven Americans at the Anderson Galleries. Critic Edmund Wilson observed, "Georgia outblazed the other painters in the exhibit." As he saw it, the men still seemed to be separated from their subjects, while O'Keeffe's had the uncanny ability to arrest attention within the space and the color of the painting. And it left him exclaiming about the fierce white line that strikes like an electric spark. kept thinking about the white rose when I read that. A year later, painter Charles DeMuth, in December 1926, spoke of flowers and flames, and color, color not as volume or light, only color. The last mad throb of red, just as it turns green, the ultimate shriek of orange, calling upon all the heavens, the blues of heavens, for relief or for support. This Georgia O'Keeffe is able to use. I often think he's describing a sunset, but then I look at the kina and I believe that O'Keeffe has found a way to intensify even further the power of a sunset in that flower. This is a pattern of leaves, a painting once owned by, was owned by Lewis Mumford. O'Keeffe's ambition for invention extended further. There are indications that chromotherapy may have been a part of her research. Writing to critic Blanche Mathias in 1926, O'Keeffe mentioned, "I'm learning something myself. I don't know exactly what it is, but if I did, I could put it clearly into form, and it would cure you." This line of thinking gained currency in Murdoch Pemberton's tongue-in-cheek reference that year to the psychiatrist sending patients to see St. Georgia, and his description of the hall of the Anderson Galleries being littered with mental crutches, eye bandages, and slings for the soul. However, in 1929, critic Lewis Mumford, and this was his painting, seemed sincere when he offered O'Keeffe the following testimonial about the curative impact of her work. He said, "When I reached the lowest depth of winter depression last week, lying in bed with a sore throat, I asked Sophie to put your picture, that of the flaming and somber oak leaves, in front of me so I could see it, and I swear it aided my recovery, giving me an assurance that life was somewhere, if not in me." And here you see the caricature of Georgia O'Keeffe as the Lady of the Lily. Eventually, O'Keeffe would come to equate the abstraction of painting, In 1929, the year the callus unfurled fully a yard wide, the caricaturist Miguel Carubias dubbed O'Keeffe Our Lady of the Lily in the New Yorker. Truly, the painter and the flower had become one in the public mind. Eventually, and this is where I'm going to certainly give the nod to Indianapolis for the most spectacular giant flower painting ever. Eventually, O'Keeffe herself would come to equate the abstraction of painting, and flower painting at that, with the emancipation of all women. In 1930, on the occasion of the opening of her first exhibition at Stieglitz's new gallery in American Place, it became the stuff of headlines in an interview on March 16th in the edition of The World, when social activist Michael Gold challenged O'Keeffe, then living and working in comfort on the 30th floor of the Shelton Hotel, asking her to explain the socially redeeming value of her art. Gold's assertion, made at the beginning of the Great Depression with rapidly rising unemployment and business bankruptcies, was simple. The struggle of the working class is the only possible subject for great art. As he said, "We are weary of the prettified, artificial evasions that are only fit only to decorate the drawing rooms and boudoirs which hold drunk parties and keep the women of the rich." Gold, like Greenberg, was saying, "Not modern." But O'Keeffe was still a card-carrying member of the National Women's Party and contended there was a connection between her fight against the oppression of women of all classes and her creations of the abstractions of painting. As she said, "One has affected the other." Moreover, O'Keeffe contended that the real thematic content of her painting, namely form, color, and pattern, bore witness not only to her personal liberation, but also to the potential for a new perfection of design that could add to life. So she concluded in this interview, "So I have no hesitancy in contending that my painting of a flower may be just as much a product of this age as a cartoon about the freedom of women or the working class or anything else." I thought we might put this idea to the test, this idea that Dow's conception of design, this idea of empowerment, tapping the power that lies within in her education, could possibly connect with social issues, as O'Keefe contended hers did. So I'm going to show you a set of images about Jacob Lawrence, the African-American artist known as the first African-American artist to be represented by a downtown gallery and to achieve acclaim and be incorporated into major modern museums. Here's Jacob Lawrence in the Harlem Workshop. Here he's working on woodcuts based upon these textile designs. Here is the Utopia Children's House with set up for children's workshops and an after-school program set up by James Wells. So interestingly, at the moment that O'Keefe is talking to Michael Gold about her own liberation and the liberation of all women, there were graduates of Columbia University Teachers College and proponents of Dow and Dewey's reforms in education. They were setting up after-school programs and art workshops in Harlem, operating in a totally different arena. But here, just the same, were Dow's exercises with pattern, and these exercises in pattern enabled Jacob Lawrence, the young Jacob Lawrence, who started off in Harlem in 1930 at the Utopia Children's House, and then worked his way through the Harlem workshops as a teenager, to develop his own color triads and temper paints of the workshops and structure narratives on hardboard panels to make visible what previously had been invisible in American culture, that is, the lives and history of African Americans. So here you, on this panel here is from the Harriet Tubman series, and he's depicting slaves in shackles here, and you can see the encoded colors setting up patterns of and structuring the space, again, without a debt to, it's his own invention, and without a debt to give a given history of art. He will also pay tribute to laundresses like his mother, and he will show the value of work, the nobility of work. He will dress the workers in white, which is a sign of their heroism, and the patterns in the clothing, especially here, we're seeing some have related to Cuba African textiles. To apprehend what Lawrence called in these patterns a beauty in struggle. Lawrence will lure you into his compositions with these gorgeous colors, and then he will surprise you with the truth. They are not just pretty pictures. Just as O'Keefe's flowers are not merely pretty pictures. We do well to remember O'Keefe's statement in 1923 before her show at the Anderson Gallery. She said, "One day 7 years ago, I found myself saying, I can't live where I want to, can't go where I want to, can't do what I want to, can't even say what I want to. Things that painters have taught me even keep me from painting as I want to. So I decided I was a very stupid fool. Not to the least, I could at least paint as I wanted to, say what I wanted to." This was her statement and her retrospective in 1923. So when you find her in 1930 telling Michael Gold, I'm liberated. And it's interesting to think about that after 1930, of course, when O'Keeffe was free to go and to live where she wanted to, and ultimately she did go and spend time in the Southwest, that she was able to develop two more modern inventions that I just want to show you quickly. So I brought back the pelvis, and I call this invention, and this is very irreverent, but I'm just going to say it, I call it pelvis vision. I think it's an invention for seeing, just as the giant flowers were inventions for seeing. Now, you remember the story in O'Keeffe's biography that Stieglitz could not remain faithful, that in fact he had an ongoing affair with Dorothy Norman, and that O'Keeffe suffered emotionally as a result of this. And the 30s were a checkered period in her work production. But it's very clear that by 1937, a sadder but wiser O'Keeffe would savor the desert by sorting a barrel of bones. You see her here in 1937. There she is. And she wrote, bones cut sharply to the center of something that is keenly alive in the desert, even though it is vast and empty and untouchable, and knows no kindness in its beauty. So you've got something beautiful and harsh, you have these opposites coming together, something dead, a bone, the sort of dead stuff, and yet something alive. Well, O'Keeffe's philosophy helps her sort through this paradox, and she begins turning bones upside down and sideways in the spaces of her compositions, operating them in a world of forms that opened long ago by Dow at Columbia. And Dow would quote Hegel's philosophy of art. And now Hegel's philosophy of art declared that all materials are dead without art. Wood and stone and metal, canvases, even words, are in themselves dead stuff. Art creates upon dead stuff. That's what Dow said. What art creates is upon this dead stuff. Also current in her reading from the 1940s was a passage from Lawrence Binion's Flight of the Dragon that espoused the beauty of space. He said, space, therefore empty space, becomes a positive factor, no longer something filled or left over, but something exerting attractive power to the eye and balancing the attractive power of forms and masses. So her solution is to animate the bones and make space a thing. And the pelvis itself becomes a lens that cuts into that space and fixes the eye on something immaculate, but uninhabitable. I just think that your painting is so beautiful, and I think it's so much fun to look at the blue as it is isolated and seen through the elements of that bone. One more invention. The patio, specifically the door. The patio, even in its ruined state, captured O'Keeffe's attention as the strongest architectural feature of the house in Abiquiu. She admired its proportions, particularly the effect of its enclosure. And I did not come up with a great photo of the patio. I did get two of the walls pictured, and I also showed you the contrast here, the light. Here is O'Keeffe standing here. This, I believe, is the door to the guest room where her sister often stayed. This, I believe, is truly a sister of some order. O'Keefe bought this ruin in Abiquiu from the Catholic Church. And it took her a long time to convince them to sell it to her, this property on the Mesa in Abiquiu, but she was able to do it. And she spent a good part of the last part of her career developing paintings out of this, what was essentially a light box. It's a light well, a well of light. Daylight radiates white and hot and purges detail. Only raking light acknowledges contours, and at night, the upper contours of the wall snaps one's attention into the sky. I personally have a vivid recollection of doing some research at the house in Abiquiu. I was in her book room. It was in November, so it became dark early. I remember stepping out onto the patio that evening, bright sky, lots of stars, and the effect of that wall, the effect of the top contour of that wall, that snap, that visual jump, was something I will never forget, and it is one of my very favorite experiences. And the way in which she used this architectural feature as a mechanism for seed, it became, I think, her final and great invention for seed space. More than once, a blind and ancient O'Keefe, and this is not as ancient as she became, because she died at nearly 100, the age of 100. But she was blind, and she was ancient, and truly modern. O'Keefe would send her caretaker across that patio to the book room for philosophies that Dow had first opened to her. In particular, there were repeated requests for Okakura's Book of Tea, and the Chinese Taoist book, The Secret of the Golden Flower, and Kandinsky's Concerning the Spiritual and Art. These books, like old friends, afforded moments of insight and reflection and assurance. Such assurance brought real meaning to her modernity. There is nothing, no color, no emotion, no idea that a true artist cannot find to express. And thank you so much.